Hi there, my name's Andy Young and I'm one of the automotive lecturers down at Unitech in Auckland, New Zealand, and welcome to my Andy Mechanic YouTube channel. Now, as you can see, TDR250 is still on the stand, on the hoist. In the last episode, episode 6 I believe it was, we got the bike up and running. We did the YPVS installation and calibration, got the bike fired up, and it fired up really quickly, dead easy. But we did a dry run, which basically means there was no coolant in the cooling system. Now that was deliberate because we wanted to be able to see, if the bike was going to start up without any problems. There's no point in putting all the radiator and fuel tank and all that kind of stuff on there if it wasn't going to start. So it ran and everything looked fine. So Ben put the fuel tank back on and the exhaust and all those bits and pieces and the radiator and filled it up with coolant and started the bike again with really the aim of doing a road test. And as it warmed up to operating temperature, we noticed a leak. And the leak was coming from the new copper head gasket. Now, we've never fitted a copper head gasket before, so we were a little bit dubious as to how good it was going to be, but it does seem to be an industry standard, certainly within the race teams, and as an option for two-stroke engines as well. So, the leak. Well, it was basically coolant that was leaking, and it's leaking just above the right-hand exhaust. So I'll take you across now, and I think there's some remnants of coolant on the barrel and you'll be able to see what I mean. And then I'm going to talk you through a possible remedy and we're going to give that a go and see what happens. Okay, so Ben spotted the coolant. Let's just get to focus for you. There we go. Look. Ben spotted the coolant leaking from just around this front part of the head gasket on the right hand cylinder, and that's a bit of a problem. You can see, if I just take the camera around there, oh there you go, look, you can see the residue of the coolant that's dribbled out, and you can actually see in that gap there, you can see the coolant. So we're going to do our very best to come up with a plan and fix the problem so we can get the bike back on the road. So it didn't take very long to start leaking, and it wasn't really up to operating pressure on the cooling system. It hadn't pressurized at that point, it had just started to leak. So Ben turned the engine off and reported the bad news. Now there are a few temptations here to try and fix the problem. The first temptation is, well, hey, look, let's just crank up the head bolts a bit tighter and increase the clamping effect on that gasket. You really, really mustn't do that. If you increase the clamping force, so I'm told, by any more than about 10%, then you do drastically risk distorting the head and the barrels, and all that's going to do is make the problem worse and not better. So I did some investigation work, and it turns out it's pretty common practice to spray the new gasket, the copper gasket, with a special copper gasket spray. And I was completely unaware of this because I haven't really been involved with fitting copper gaskets in the past, and I'll show you the stuff. So there are a few companies out there that make this this spray, and one of the companies is VHT, and that's VHT copper gasket cement, they call it on their can. And basically it tells us we've got to make sure the gasket's lovely and clean, spray it, and then leave the gasket for at least 5 minutes for the paint, essentially that coating, to dry. But the gasket must be fitted within 2 hours of spraying. Now there are other manufacturers out there that make these sprays. I think one's called K&W copper gasket spray. I think it's an American brand. I found it on the CRC website here in New Zealand, but it turns out that they've never brought it in. It wasn't their own. It's one that obviously that they buy in, but they don't distribute it in New Zealand, unfortunately. There's also Halimar in the UK make a copper gasket spray, and I am told from the number of people I've spoken to that the Halimar one is the best, but hey, who knows. So the only one I could find, oh, battery's charged. So the only one I could find here in New Zealand in Auckland, with the limited time that I had available, was this VHT, and I got this one through the Repco outlets. They stock it as a standard item. And this sort of stuff's pretty popular for use on the V8 engines with the cast iron heads and blocks, obviously. And they tend to use copper gaskets within the race fraternity, mainly because they can reuse them. So I'm told you can reuse a copper gasket up to 5 times. So obviously each and every time you pull it out, you give it a good clean down, and you reapply some of this spray, let it dry and stick it in. Easy as that. So we're going to give it a go. I really don't know if it's going to work or not. If it doesn't, then have to do some more research and find out another option. There are some machining options where you actually get basically a tiny recess machined into the head on each and every sealing surface, so around every single one of the coolant apertures and around the cylinder, and you lay in a small round section of stainless steel wire, basically, or a stainless steel ring. And what that does is it creates a high pressure contact point for the gasket surface. But that's a hell of a lot of work, and I don't really want to go down that route. Partly because one little mistake and it's probably going to leak anyway. Now, you've already seen on previous videos covering the TDR work me removing the cylinder head, so there's no point in me filming that yet again. So I'll get the cylinder head removed from the engine. We'll take a quick look at the gasket, see if there's any possible obvious failures of that gasket, which I find highly unlikely. I'll give it a clean up, and then we'll apply this gasket spray, this copper gasket spray, give it a few minutes to dry off, and then you can watch me build it back up, and we'll get the bike running and really see what happens. Okay, here we go. Right, well, that's all the bolts undone. Now it's a little bit tighter. Oh, I've left a bolt, a wire up. Hang on, let's see if I can get that off. There we go. Okay, so it's a lot tighter now getting this head off because of all the other bits and pieces that are in place, but I reckon we can do it. So just ease that up. I don't want to scratch the cylinder head, if I can help it. Oh, we've got power valve stuff in the way. Hang on. There we go. Okay, we'll swing that around and see if we can just get it out. Oh, spark the wires in the way. Man, it's tight. It was tight before. Let's see if we can spin it around the other way. Don't want me taking the fuel tank off because it's got the two-stroke tank built in, and all the two-stroke system's now primed as well. Bendy that as well before you fired it up. Okay, clutch cable, there we go. Oh, it's looking good. Looking pretty good. Why, Yamaha? Why would you do this to me? Okay, coming around. Okay, I think we'll have to take this off. Yeah, 8 mil. Wow, that wasn't very tight, Benjamin. Sheesh. Okay. It's not dropping any of the copper washers anywhere. Okay. Cool. See, that's going to give us the magic clearance that we need. Oh, look at that. Perfect. Right, now for the head gasket. Carefully does it. Don't want to go bending this. Ben will be very upset. Yeah. Right, and the failure, the leak was down here, but he also said that he saw some coolant coming out of the left hand cylinder, so there must have been a leak between here and the cylinder itself somewhere. Anyway, I don't know where. Right, so I'll give this a good clean up and we'll go and look at the gasket. Okay, so we know the cylinder head's good because that's just been skimmed, so I'll just give that a bit of a clean, and then we can refit that later on. The gasket. Well, it's brand new, isn't it? We just had it made up. So, giving it a bit of a clean off, trying to find some kind of rag that isn't too dirty. I suppose we should do it flat. Let's do that. Right, time for a nice clean rag. Okay. So the problem areas were, this is the top of the gasket, by the way. The problem area, it was leaking around here externally. And I think we must have had some kind of an internal leak around this area, somewhere between one of these water galleries. So, not that there's really much to see, to be honest, because we only ran it up for a few minutes. And you can see that there's hardly any kind of imprint in the machining of the head or the barrels on the actual gasket itself. Now, one thing we can do with these gaskets, with them in copper, is we can anneal them. We can warm them up to a particular temperature and then allow them to cool naturally, and that's going to make the copper softer. And of course, if it's softer, it's going to adapt and mould to the minor imperfections on the aluminium surfaces either side of it. And that's the whole idea of a gasket, let's face it. But before we go down that route, I want to try this spray first and see if we can sort that out. See if that's going to cure the problem. If it's not, then we're going to have to anneal the gasket, I think. But that's probably going to be another video. One step at a time. That's the important thing. Okay. Now, it does say you've got to get these gaskets super clean before applying the paint. But that's good enough for now, just to have a quick look at. And, well, yeah, okay, there's a couple of little dents in it, but, I mean, there's plenty of material around that dent, so shouldn't be a problem. I mean, I didn't expect to find anything, to be honest. I think it's just the fact that the gasket itself, the clamping force, we're only dealing with 22 newton meters, which is very, very low. Obviously, on a big V8 engine that's got a cast iron head, cast iron block, they can probably crank these, increase the clamping force considerably. Most car engines have a much higher torque setting for the head bolts, so that could be one of the issues. We're not, we're not in the same ballpark as what those guys are. So, all right, I'll continue to clean this up. We'll get it squeaky clean, and then I'll show you how to apply the copper gasket spray. Okay. Both gasket surfaces, that's the cylinder head and the tops of both the barrels, are really, really clean now. I thought I'd just run through the application of this, what it says on the can. It's going to vary between different manufacturers. But on this one, prepare the gasket surface by removing the old gasket material with the proper tools. Wipe the surface down with grease and wax remover. Why use brake cleaner? Because it doesn't leave any residue. It's pretty good stuff. Shake the can vigorously for 1 full minute after the mixing ball moves freely, and 10 seconds after each minute of use. Lay the gasket down on a piece of cardboard. We have cardboard. Spray on a thin coat just thick enough to evenly cover the surface of both sides of the gasket. And you must use this between temperatures of 16 degrees C and 35 degrees C. Well, if you're in America, then at 60 degrees Fahrenheit, whatever that means, and 95 degrees Fahrenheit. And then, once it's done, wait 5 minutes or until the film becomes tacky, apply the gasket to the surface and tighten as soon as possible, and certainly within 2 hours. Okay, so I'm gonna get my torque wrench, I can be getting my torque wrench ready whilst it's going tacky, that'll work. Okay, let's get this shaken up. Okay, let's do a little test spray on the cardboard first. Okay, it's pretty good. Don't really know what to expect, to be honest, but we'll give it a go. Right, and I put a little tiny notch just on this side of the gasket where there's no sealing surface, just to let me know that this is the upside of the gasket. This is the side of the gasket that's going to go onto the cylinder head. Now, the only reason why I've done that is because this gasket's already been fitted once, and there are some indents on the other side that match the cylinders. Okay. Woohoo. Right, we'll give that a minute or two just to dry before I flick it over. Okay, that's a couple of minutes gone, so try and pick it up from somewhere that's not going to be a ceiling surface. And we'll just flick it over, as it says in the book, on the can. And we'll give it another go on this side. Pretty good, and it's pretty even. Fingers crossed. Now, it also says to invert the can when you've finished, just to make sure you've got no more, not going to dry in the nozzle. There we go. Smells fantastic. Okay, well here goes. I'm going to use some pliers to just hold the gasket rather than my fingers, because this paint is really tacky. And I just don't want to damage it. Oh, this is not going to be easy at all. It could be a lot easier at the fuel tank in position. Oh yeah, okay, things are looking good. Almost there. Jeez. Don't want to touch it anywhere. I need to. There we go. Okay. Right. Gasket's on. Woohoo! Just gonna get this head back in again. Every single time, it's a bit of a nightmare. It doesn't seem to be any. I can never remember how it goes in. Not gonna work. There we go. No idea how that happened. Right. Bring it round. There's all sorts of stuff in the way now, unfortunately. It's a bit of a problem. This is kind of cold, so really awkward. Sorry about the sound. It's pouring down the rain outside. Okay, we shouldn't be far off at that. There we go. Okay. Right, time for some bolts. Nuts and bolts, bolts and nuts. Try and put them on as evenly as I possibly can, I think. I'm trying to give this thing a best chance of working. It seems to be a bit picky. Alright, so doesn't forget the guard at the front. I'm always forgetting that. Get that on. Okay, I'm just going to whiz around and give them a little tweak with this first to get them all seated. So number one, where the hell was number one? Three, one, there we go. That's two up there. Three. Oops. Sorry, my fault. Three. Sorry, TDR. Four. And number 10. All right, time for a torque wrench. Quick as we can, already preset to 22 Newton meters. So number one. That's one, okay. Two. Three's around here. Number four. There we go. Okay, it's torqued down. I'll put the rest of it back together and we'll get it fired up. Okay, so it's all back together. The radiator's on now. I've not fitted the exhaust pipes. Now there's a reason for that. Is it's a lot easier to see for leaks and check for leaks without the exhausts on. But secondly, every time we fit those exhausts, the gaskets, the exhaust gaskets get squashed a bit more and more. And this bike does have a bit of a problem with when you reuse the exhaust gaskets, because it gets a bit of a two-stroke oil leak, gooey black residue running down the cylinders, and we don't particularly want that. So only once we're certain that the exhausts, that the head gasket is going to be sealed, then we'll put the exhaust on and do a road test, but not today. Okay, let's get it started up, fill the garage with smoke, probably knock a few days off my lifetime, and see if we're going to get another oil, another water leak from that gasket.
Thank you.
Okay. Update status, whatever you want to call it. As I was running the bike up, over a period of time, I noticed that it stopped smoking. Now, that's an indication that we're not getting the two-stroke oil coming through the pump. It's got an automatic pump that injects the two-stroke into the intake manifold. Now, Ben had mixed up some premix and put it in the fuel tank, but hey, it still wasn't smoking, and I don't like that. Not on a new engine, it needs plenty of lubrication. So we almost got up to temperature, but I had to abort the test, unfortunately. I've now mixed up some fresh fuel with two-stroke oil in it, so we've got a premix mixture in the fuel tank, which isn't normal for a TDR, but it's going to allow the bike to run that little bit longer so that the pump primes up properly and we actually get two-stroke being injected into the intake manifold for both cylinders. Now, that's probably going to cause it to smoke absolutely tons, but as soon as that starts to happen, then I can stop and just add some normal fuel to the fuel tank to dilute off the premix mixture, so it shouldn't be too bad, because we don't want to be oiling up plugs and things. But on the other hand, I don't want the bike to seize up or even score the barrel, because that would be terrible after all this work we've done. Okay, so we're nearly there. I've had a quick look round, and so far there are no leaks. And yes, the coolant system has started to pressurize. So I'm going to restart the bike. First of all, I'm going to drain the carbs, so we've got some fuel in there that we know has definitely got the two-stroke mixture. Get it restarted, and hopefully we're going to get a bit more smoke again, so we know that we've got lubrication to the engine components. Okay, here we go. Actually have too much two-stroke smoke in your lungs. I found out today. Okay, well, it's definitely up to temperature. Actually, bang on really, if not getting a little bit too warm, because it doesn't have an electric fan, so it doesn't like to be stood for a long time running. You might have noticed that the revs took a long time to come down. Now, that's normally an indication of an air leak, or possibly one of the manual chokes on the carburetors is stuck a little bit. This bike has been stood for a year, so there's every possibility that one of those little choke plungers in one of the carbs is sticking a little bit. So I'll have to take a look at that sometime. But I also think because the exhausts and not the expansion chambers are not in position, they're not there, that also can affect it as well, I think. But hey, that's a different problem for another day. So let's go and across the bike. We'll have a look and see if we can find any leaks, on the coolant system. Okay. So, just starting around the back. Oh, golly, sorry, camera. There we go, look. So it's, and you can actually see right down between the cylinders. I know it's not ideal on the camera. You can see the new gasket, you can see that spray that's sort of oozed out because you've got to apply it tacky so it molds a bit. So, looking around. Now, it was around this surface here at the front of the right-hand cylinder we had a leak, and that's bone dry now, which is really good. Probably not see too much around this side, but we'll give it a go. There we go, look, so nice and dry again. And it is possible to see, especially from the other side, you can actually see down and across the front of the head as well, across the front of the cylinders. It's a bit hard on the camera, but
this side's definitely a pass. And we're definitely up to temperature and pressure. This hose now is really, really quite hard to squeeze, which tells us we're up to pressure in the cooling system. So it's a really good pressure test. Let's whiz around the other side and have a look. Okay, again, around this side, a few more pipes in the way, unfortunately, but, you know, we've got coolant in there, so there'd be obviously a green would show up pretty quickly on the camera, real easy to see. And all that's, again, dry, which is really good. I think Ben is going to be extremely happy when he gets home tonight. That's cool. So I'm going to let Ben finish off putting the exhaust on and stuff. I've sort of done my job now on this one for now. But no, he's going to be really chuffed. Okay, back to the workbench. So you might have noticed me, whilst the engine was running, checking the, well, two things I checked actually. One is I took off one of the output pipes of the two-stroke pump to see if we were getting those little tiny pulses of two-stroke oil being injected into the intake manifold. And also, when I unplugged the pipe from the intake manifold, the engine RPM picked up very slightly. And that told me that the little jet or the intake that that pipe connects to isn't blocked, because now the engine's sucking air and it starts to run lean, so of course the engine RPM goes up. Obviously it's only sucking air on one cylinder, but it does still have an effect on engine RPM. So that checked that for me, and I did see two-stroke oil pumping through that pipe. So that tells me that the two-stroke pump is now primed and working correctly. And we were obviously seeing smoke coming out of the cylinders, which was telling me that obviously the premix was also doing its trick. But now, you know, there's no need for premix in the tank. We've got the pump primed, it's working. We can just fill the fuel tank up with high octane fuel, 98 fuel, and forget all about it, basically. That extra little bit of a two-stroke oil in the fuel tank won't do the engine any harm. In fact, it'll probably help a little bit during the running in period. The other test that I did, other than just smoke, is you can just get a bit of cardboard, and this is the bit that I did the spraying of the gasket on. I did basically like a splatter test, you know, so with the exhaust being off, I could see the unburnt oil residue being, you know, it was basically spraying onto the cardboard. And again, that's another really quick test to make sure that you are actually getting two-stroke oil, you know, going through the cylinders and lubricating everything, because not all of it burns, you know, some of it comes out as just oil anyway, so makes it nice and easy. Okay, so what did we find out on this video? Well, we found out that this stuff does actually work. Pretty cool, eh? Thumbs up to VHT copper gasket cement. It did the trick and it saved the day, and I think this cost about $20 New Zealand, so it wasn't expensive either. And now we know whenever we use that copper gasket, we're going to have to spray it with this first. Conclusive proof that it works, actually. Pretty good. Okay, well, I wonder if there'll be any more. Yes, there'll probably be one more episode to the TDR. Oh, there's going to be a couple more, actually, because I've got the two-stroke oil pump to rebuild. We've got a whole new load of parts for it, and I want to recalibrate it, because Ben was thinking that it was getting a bit too much two-stroke oil, but these TDRs do smoke a lot. Just like RD350LCs, 250LCs, all that kind of stuff, they smoke tremendously. And that's just all part of having a two-stroke bike, Benjamin. So yeah, there'll still be another video which will include maybe the road test and really signing the job off, because we've not done the road test yet. There's still a few more checks to do. I've got those carbs to sort out, that slow engine RPM fall to fix, whether it's an air leak or whether it's those chokes, I just don't know. We'll wait and see. But this brings us to the end of this video being basically covering the importance of using copper gasket cement spray when using copper head gaskets, or any kind of gaskets, I suppose. Okay, crew, well, if you've got any questions or comments, then please do add them down the bottom, and I'll do my very best to get back to you as soon as I possibly can. If you'd like to subscribe to the channel, then why not click on the subscribe icon, and then you'll notice once you subscribe, there'll be a little gear symbol right next to it. Click on the gear symbol,
and then you can, it'll open up a new little mini window thing on your device, and you can turn on notifications, and that way you're going to get an email or whichever format of notification you choose sent through to you, usually every time I upload a video. But YouTube for some reason doesn't seem to send out notifications every single time. I don't know what's going on there. It used to do, but not anymore. But turn that on, and then hopefully, fingers crossed, you'll get most of them. Well, my name's Andy Young, and I'm one of the automotive lecturers down at Unitech in Auckland. I've learned all about copperhead gaskets on this last couple of episodes of the TDR. I hope you enjoyed watching the video, and well, welcome to the Andy Mechanic YouTube channel if it's your first time. If you want to communicate with me in alternative methods, then you will find my email address and PO box within the details on YouTube. You can also message me through, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and Google+ as well. There's all sorts of little icons on the homepage that you can click on that will take you through to my various pages. I'm not massive on social media, but I do post every now and again, stuff about the video channel on YouTube. And hey, there is some extra background information that goes up there sometimes as well. So, check it out. Okay, crew, thanks for watching. Cheers. Over and out.